National Federation of the Blind. Live the life you want through science, technology, engineering, and math.
As part of a grant from the National Science Foundation, the National Federation of the Blind collaborated with science museums around the country to increase accessibility for blind visitors. Staff from some of those museums reflect on their experience in this video.
What is the biggest thing you've learned in this partnership with the National Federation of the Blind?
Nora Moynihan, Port Discovery, Baltimore.
Making these kinds of modifications and doing the kinds of things that we're being expected and you know, as part of the partnership is not a far stretch. It's totally easy stuff to do, and we're happy to do it. And for us, we feel like it's just value added constantly because, again, we want to invite everybody to this museum, and we want them to have a great time while they're here. So whatever we're doing through this grant is good for everybody.
Keith Braafladt, Science Museum of Minnesota.
Yeah, we're also sort of seeing kind of social emotional things that are changing. With each one of us, when we've been able to work directly with the blind person, you have all these preconceptions, all these ideas, and most of them are wrong. And what you really have to do is adjust and try to behave as yourself, but also be more open about your questions and your ideas. And that openness is reciprocated by the staff who we've met. It's been really helpful. And learning how to be comfortable with working with someone blind in a sighted world in terms of language, in terms of the way that you just navigate both the social and physical world is I think that's the central aspect for our volunteers and for the facilitation as well.
Daniel Davis, Boston Museum of Science.
Well, I've learned about the virtuous cycle between relationship and accessibility. It's hard to know what barriers there are to accessibility if you don't have a relationship, and that relationship can inform better practices for improving that accessibility. I think the key to improving the ascent in that upward spiral has been training, and with that training has been increased awareness that's allowed us to further improve our best practices, and then getting partner feedback from our NFB affiliates has helped add to the feedback for that.
Joe Wood, COSI, Columbus.
The concept of universal design. So essentially, as we increase our accessibility of our exhibits for people with visual impairments, we also are making those exhibits better for all of our guests. And I think that's the most important lesson.
Marjorie Bequette, Science Museum of Minnesota.
I think across the board, it's just one of my favorite things. This has been such a mutual learning experience, you know, with everybody that we've been able to partner with so far. We have expertise, we have stuff to learn. The different folks from the NFB have expertise and have stuff to learn. And it's been great to be able to come together and learn together from each other and with each other.
What modifications did you have to make to your programs? Sarah Zimmerman, Port Discovery, Baltimore.
We didn't design these programs for blind kids. We took the programs that we already had designed for our after-school programs, our school group programs. We modified them for the format that the camp was going to take, how much time I had and where it was going to be. And, you know, we just ran through the activities with Natalie, and she's like, yep, this is good. No, this isn't. You know, make this small change. And it was really easy and simple. And I was surprised because I wasn't sure which activities would be appropriate, and pretty much all of them were appropriate, and we were able to keep them with a couple of small modifications. And it was surprising to me, I guess, that, you know, I didn't have to do anything drastically different. I just had to think about how I was explaining things and make sure I was utilizing their other senses.
I think that it's been so important for us because the changes are little and simple, but it isn't always obvious to us which are the little and simple changes to make. That's insight that comes from working with the NFB. And I think that's because sometimes the changes, the little simple changes that we might instinctively make are not the most important ones to make, and in fact are really important to not make.
Right? Ann Jennings, Exploritorium, San Francisco.
The modifications really had to do more with how we introduced and explained the things that the kids were working with, not so much the activity itself. So it was an exercise in us understanding how to describe better and give visual descriptions, and how to use materials and distribute materials in a way that was super accessible for the kids.
Tell us about a specific modification you made to an activity.
The use of the microphone for the Alka-Seltzer tablet. So, you know, me being me, of course, you know, showed Natalie this experiment, and I'm like, oh yeah, you can't see the difference in the height. And she's like, well, yeah, but I can hear it. And I always ask the kids when I do the experiment on the museum floor, you know, can you hear the fizzing? And so, you know, I'm very aware that you can hear the reaction happening. And she's like, well, you can also hear the change in the pitch as the fizz rises in the tubes, and you can hear how long each of them fizz. So we set up a microphone in the sound system that's in that room, and we're able to play the sound of the reaction over there, and the kids could hear, you're like, oh yeah, it's rising, it's getting bigger, and oh, it's going back down. And we had one of the high school apprentices had his talking stopwatch on one of his fancy gizmos that I had no idea what it's called, and he also timed the experiment, so they were also, you know, knew that the whole tablet took a lot longer, fizzed for a lot longer than the crushed tablet did, and they heard the differences that the crushed tablet went higher. And that was one of the things that I didn't necessarily think about up front and that we were able to do, and it was really great to be able to make that modification and have that work out so well.
Another thing that we have really learned is, as far as modification, to give an example, is that we have wind tubes, or they're supposed to build some sort of contraption that's going to hover in an airstream. Well, if you can't see where your object is, how will you know where it is in that wind tube? We looked at some sort of high-tech modifications, but what ended up being the best was simply tying a string to the wind machine, and then you can feel how high up it is based on how much string has been pulled out.
What impact do you think this partnership will have on your museum and your community in general? Kathryn Guimond, Science Museum of Minnesota.
I would share that making the connection locally to the local NFB chapter here, did a site visit there, which was really interesting, and in seeing how they were doing carpentry at their site. I think there's also opportunities for us to work with blind youth in working positions here at the museum, so made a connection with a gentleman there that does summer internships with youth, and talking about how could we do that here at the museum. So I think that connection was really important, and how we can continue this work after the event on Saturday.
I think a really great thing that's happened is that as we've worked to make things more accessible, they seem to be making them more interesting as well. So it started growing and directing our activities and our motivation around those activities. So that's been really cool, actually, to do that work.
What advice do you have for anyone working with blind students?
Say not to get hung up on language. For example, it's perfectly acceptable to say, look here, provided that what you have is actually here, and if it's at a different location, locate where it's at or why it's relevant.
Most importantly, relax. And don't worry about offending somebody or, you know, saying something dumb. The kids really just want to interact with you, and they want to have a great time just like you do. So just act natural, I suppose, and don't worry so much, because you guys are going to have a great time.
Don't assume that blind kids aren't learning just as fast and just as intensely as any other kids. The learning experience is about what we're trying to teach, not how we're trying to teach it. And we can modify our methods to engage kids in content, and they are as curious and as insightful and as full of questions and discoveries as any other learner.
Very simple things make it accessible. Very simple changes.
Joe Imholte, Science Museum of Minnesota.
It's not nearly as challenging as you might initially think.
Is there anything else you'd like to share about your accessibility modifications?
I would say that a high point was actually this afternoon when we had 5 Braille reading teenagers looking at a prototype of our tactile map and hearing their insightful criticism of something that, but also that they went, whoa, when they first saw it. This is incredible. So we feel like we've done something really great. And at the same time, we're building on this prototype that we've developed to get input from the community and very real kind of feedback. And to me, that's like the heart of what this organization is all about, is trying to develop things that respond to a need in the community, and then asking the community to tell us, did we get it right, and how could we make it better? And so we're doing that, and hopefully we can continue that kind of collaboration.
For more information, visit www.blindscience.org. This material is based upon work supported by the National Science Foundation under grant number 1322855. Any opinions, findings, and conclusions or recommendations expressed in this material are those of the authors and do not necessarily reflect the views of the National Science Foundation.